thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
2019, 7 p.m. meeting of Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I am Chair Amy Scott Gailey, and we have Commissioner Sutton, Commissioner Boswell, Commissioner Lashley, and Commissioner Carter here present tonight. And Vice Chair Boswell, if you would please lead us in the invocation.
Be glad to. Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all the blessings you give us. Lord, we ask for your protection upon all of our first responders, our police officers across this country, as they're, a lot of them being looked at badly. Just look after them, protect them. God be with our military as they are here and abroad. Protect them. Help us tonight as we go through the county's business. Help us to make wise decisions and do what's best for the county. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Can you please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, at this time in our meeting, we have public speakers who are wishing to address the board on agenda-related items. And tonight, we have one person who has signed up for this time, and that is Donna Poe. Ms. Poe, if you would come on up and introduce yourself. Thank you.
Thank you once again for the opportunity to speak to you. I am Donna Poe from Snow Camp, and I'm speaking tonight on behalf of our community concerning the noise ordinance revision. We appreciate your listening to the members of our community and your attention to our concerns regarding said ordinance. I know this has taken quite a while to get to this revision, and we thank you so much for all your efforts. And it now appears to have some protection for the rights of our citizens to a peaceful life in Snow Camp and throughout the county. I realize that enforcing it will be another issue, but we believe that this is a good start. So we thank you again for your diligence and patience as we work through this critically important noise ordinance revision. I am sure you can appreciate that our community is passionate about every potential impact of the proposed Snow Camp mine, including noise. The revised noise ordinance that now protects the rights of the citizens to peaceful life should further entice home development in Snow Camp and all of Alamance County. On behalf, again, of our community and the over 700 individuals who signed the petition to remove the industry exemption from the Alamance County Noise Ordinance, please, once again, with our heartfelt gratitude, we thank you for your continued concern and care for our citizens. And to God be the glory. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, do we have any commissioner responses? Okay. That being said, if everyone has had a chance to review the agenda, if we could have a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Then we have the consent agenda there with just a couple of items for your review.
I would like to make a motion that we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, on to presentations and other business. We have tonight the 2019 North Carolina Association of County Commissioners 4-H Youth Voice Delegate. Young man, Mr. Will White is here. Will, if you will come forward. And you are welcome to address the board.
So, good afternoon. My name is Will White. I'm your 4-H Alamance County Youth Delegate. I'm pleased to be here to tell you a little bit about myself and the importance of 4-H programs. Please pardon me as I read my speech because I think it's important that I don't forget anything. I'm a freshman at Western Alamance High School. I'm in the Naval Junior ROTC and in the FFA. I started the Lucky Lee 4-H Club at Western Middle School last year. I did this because there was an interest in agriculture and community service. No other club was offered at my school, so I decided to start one. We had about 45 students join in just our first meeting. We started with nothing, so my mom helped me to write a grant, and we were given about $2,000 to buy materials for our club. We also had fundraisers, and we built plant beds and grew foods that we donated to the disabled and the senior citizens in need at Burlington Homes. The seniors came and talked to us about their struggles and how hard it is not to have all the resources that they need. They were so impressed that now they want plant beds for their own apartments. I'm now going to high school where I will be in the FFA, and we have submitted a grant to ask for money to build that plant bed for the seniors. We did lots of other things like planting a tree in memory for our school secretary that passed away. We were able to do these things by using the money that we raised in our fundraisers. I am also going to lead the 4-H Environmental Science Club for Alamance County. In this club, we will learn about the importance of recycling. We will tour local farms. We will learn about air and water quality. We will also participate in local river cleanups. And in each meeting, we start with our 4-H pledge. And the pledge is, I pledge my head to clearer thinking, I pledge my heart to greater loyalty, my hands to larger service, my health to better living, my club, my community, my country, and my world. This pledge is important because it creates great citizens and leaders. I'm a good kid. I don't smoke, vape, I don't drink, and I don't use profanity. I say please and thank you, and I hold the door for people. I care about others, and the clubs that I'm involved in have helped to shape me as a person. I used to worry about being the popular kid, but not anymore. I just take pride in being myself. I am proud to be your county delegate. Thank you for your support of our 4-H programs and for allowing me the time to come and speak. I look forward to seeing you at Youth Voice.
Thank you.
Good job.
Yes, Will, have you got people here with you that you could introduce?
This is my mom, Michelle White. This is my dad, Craig White. That's Taylor Jones.
Very good. Thank you. It's good to have y'all with us. And who is that lady on?
I'm his biggest fan.
Good job, Mom and Dad and Taylor. Yeah. We're very lucky to have a great 4-H program in Alamance County. And I talked with Ms. White, I guess it was last year sometime, that she told me that there was a thought to add a 4-H program to Western Middle, and I thought it was just a wonderful idea, and I'm so happy to see it come to fruition. That's fantastic.
Yeah, that's a good program.
Yeah.
Glad you started it.
And she had pointed out to me that there are a lot of young people in middle school, you know, it's kind of a weird, awkward time sometimes for kids. And that some people don't really fit into the sports thing, or they don't fit into the boxes that are prepared for them, but they can fit. They fit into 4-H, and I think that's fantastic. She wanted that. Thank you so much. Okay, Mr. Albright, the noise ordinance is next.
Yes, if you received my copy of the changes, I think the biggest change was the added number 15 under section 6. And if you're agreeable with that language, the rest of the changes were discussed over the last several meetings. That's the only really new change in there. And it is tied to operating hours for businesses.
Right. Motion to approve that.
Beg your pardon?
I'll make a motion.
Okay. Mr. Carter has made a motion.
I'll second that.
To approve. And then we have a second. Is there any more discussion? We've had a lot of discussion about this ordinance.
Thank you, Clive, for getting that.
I think this is a really good ordinance.
I think it's a good ordinance. You've done good.
Thanks, sir.
All right. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, Mr. Haygood, we have an interlocal agreement for use of North Carolina lottery funds.
Thank you, Commissioners. Good evening. I'm for you this evening to request that the Board of Commissioners approve a memorandum of understanding between Alamance Burlington School System and Alamance County Government. This memorandum lays out the terms in which the county and the school system will agree upon how North Carolina lottery funds will be used in the future. Basically, what we're establishing in this agreement is that the first $1,459,068 of annual North Carolina lottery funds will be used by the county to pay debt service for the school system. We project this debt service will be used to pay debt for the Career and Technical Ed Center, which we still owe on. We have other existing ABSS bond debt from years past, and of course for the proposed $150 million worth of anticipated debt for the education bond projects for the school system. So the way the MOU lays out how we're proposing to use lottery funds is reflected in our capital financing plan that we've been working on for quite some time and that you've approved. And the school system, Board of Education, has approved this same agreement at their June 18th, 2019 meeting. So at this time, it's before the board to approve, and we'll try to answer any questions if you have any.
Pretty much discussed this before.
Well, and we've worked this into our capital plan.
That's too, correct.
As we were developing that, so yeah.
Yes, it's right in line with our capital plan and our capital financing.
Right.
Plan.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that interlocal agreement. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay.
Thank you.
Now we have a special event policy from.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
I have two items for you today. The first is the special event policy. This is primarily for Cedar Rock Park. We host a lot of events there. As you guys know, we always have runs and mm-hmm. tournaments and things like that. For years, we've never had anything written about how those things happen, who pays for what, who's responsible for what. And it's just time to do that. We're getting a little bit of an increase of interest, which is a good thing. We want to encourage people to use the park, but we want to be transparent with folks about what the expectations are, about what they have to pay, and who's doing what. So this policy is an attempt to do that, just put a few things down on paper to guide the public and to encourage use of the park. If there's any questions about the terms of the policy, I'm happy to go through it, but I won't read the whole thing.
I think it's a step in the right direction.
I do too. Good idea.
Good.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the special event policy for Parks and Rec. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, then we have something about getting an Impact Alamance grant. What's going on there?
Yeah, we are applying for a grant from Impact Alamance. We have had several grants from Impact Alamance. They've been a great partner for us. One of the areas where their interests and ours intersect is in helping kids be active,
right.
Underprivileged kids in particular. So they are going to help us with the playground at Pleasant Grove, just upgrading and renovating a little bit. It's a pretty popular playground. It's become more popular since Impact Alamance helped us put a walking track out there mm-hmm. last year. So now the parents have something to do while the kids are on the playground, and it's getting more people out there. So this grant would be to help us improve that playground. We're also going to put a little 9-hole beginner disc golf course there to introduce people to the sport and give the people in the northern part of the county a place to learn how to play. It's not as hard as Cedar Rock. Cedar Rock's a great course.
You don't have enough land there to make it as hard as Cedar Rock.
We don't. If you know what you're doing, Cedar Rock's a great course. If not, that's not a great place to start.
Break in at this one and then go to Cedar Rock
it's the equivalent of a par 3 golf course.
Yeah, that's for introductory
good beginner
learning,
course.
Right?
Yeah.
I would make a motion that we accept this $25,000 grant from Impact Alamance.
Second.
Well, I guess we'd be giving them permission or approval to apply for the grant.
Right.
So that's your motion?
Yeah.
Okay. And that's your second?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we have a motion and a second to approve the Parks and Rec apply for the grant from Impact Alamance. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Okay, now we have Susanna Goldman, the library director, is going to talk about the mobile library.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
So
So I have a visual that's just going to play while I'm talking. It's just pictures for your entertainment. But you'll notice the next three agenda items are all mine. They all have to do with the bookmobile, just the various parts and pieces. So we've been working on this project, as you know, for a number of years. And we finally, in May, at end of May and June, put out a request for bids from specialty vehicle vendors that build vehicles like this. We received three bids back, and after review of the bids, library staff are making a recommendation to award the bid to Matthew Specialty Vehicle, which is a vendor based out of Greensboro. If you have any questions about the bidding process or any of the answers there, please, I'm happy to answer them.
Came in considerably below the other two.
It did, yes. But even though, you know, the lowest bid is the, you know, the one you go with, they were actually the company that had the options we would have wanted anyways.
So what are the options, just for example?
Yes, I have that here. So there is probably about 11 or 13 options that we got them to price individually, so we would know if we wanted to add them, how much they were. My favorite and the one I want the most is a hybrid driveline system, which basically makes the vehicle more of an electric vehicle. So it reduces the gas costs for the future.
Right.
And so there are other things like putting a video surveillance system on the vehicle for the protection of staff and the community when we're out by ourselves in the rural parts of the community. Things like a backup camera so they can, you know, not hit stuff when they're backing up properly. People,
right.
Trees, all
that
stuff
now.
For protection of the vehicle and others. There's a number of others, and I do have a list if you'd like to see it.
How far out will the Wi-Fi extend from the vehicle?
It's a radius, and it depends on which unit we select to go in, but it should be similar to our mobile cafe, which is, I think, 300 feet from the vehicle, all the way around in a big radius. So, and we hope the vehicle will have, you know, it should have, it's built into it, so an awning on the outside that we can put, you know, collapsible furniture out for people to use the Wi-Fi while we're at a stop in the shade, as well as get onto the vehicle to check out materials or use resources.
Now, will people be able to request a book from one of the libraries and have it transported out from the library, mobile library?
Yes. Should be almost as full service as any physical library branch, just obviously much smaller than a physical
right.
library branch. So those are some examples of other bookmobiles, and it's a configuration of what it may look like on the inside for that picture. But it'll have materials for all ages, as well as a variety of technology needs, depending on what our community is looking for.
Now, utilization in the winter?
Mm-hmm. It's equipped with AC and heat, just like any physical building would, and obviously the door that swings shut automatically unless propped
right.
open.
Okay.
For the comfort of the staff person who will be on the vehicle for long hours, as well as the patrons who come and visit.
Okay, so we will be seeking approval to proceed with the purchase process with Matthew Specialty Vehicles to design and build the vehicle at the purchase price of $377,087.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to approve that purchase process. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. So next, we have something about the signing authority.
Yes, this is also for the bookmobile and for the request for bids. We are asking that you approve giving Brian Haygood, the county manager, the signing authority for any documentation necessary in filling out forms for the award of the bid process. This is an effort for us not to have to wait and come before you and ask every
right.
time we have a signature needed.
Make a motion that we give Brian that authority.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that signing authority being delegated. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and then reassigning the designated Western Library branch funds.
Yes. In 2008, 2009, and 2010, various trust payments that go to the library annually were set aside by our library committee to fund the then in progress being planned Western Elon branch for the library. Now that that project is not something that I believe Elon is moving forward with, and the we would like to have those funds, which come to a total of just under $153,000, to be your permission to be reallocated for the purchase of the bookmobile.
You have the permission of the Elon Alderman, I believe, for that too,
yes,
right?
Yes, they approved that last week.
Brian, do we need to undo that? If they're not going to utilize it, I think it's time to take that off the books.
I think the town has indicated they're no longer pursuing the Western branch idea, and these $153,000 had been given for that purpose. So Susanna and her staff went to the town and said, if you're not going to proceed with the Western Branch Library, we'd like to use the funds for the offset the cost of the bookmobile, which they agreed to.
Right.
And I think the library committee also has agreed to reassigning these funds. So if we use these monies for the bookmobile, we would be pretty much out of the business of pursuing the Western Branch.
Okay. I'm in favor of that.
The end of that.
Yeah.
Yes,
I'll make a motion to approve the reallocation.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to reassign the funds that were designated for the Western Library branch to the purchase of the mobile library, the bookmobile. Is there any more discussion?
Can we put in the agreement that that account is closed?
Yes, we would close that account out, and all funds
Elon,
would
okay.
be used for the
please bookmobile. Put that in the wording.
Yes.
And how much is in there, did you say? 400 and?
153,000.
That'll save the county a bunch of money.
$153,000.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, thank you very
Before
much.
Before we get, I am curious, what happened with that? At first they were going to put it at Joel Davison Park.
Yes.
And then Beth Schmidt Park came along, and they were going to put it out there. What Jerry Tolley was involved in all that? What happened?
I think that was around the recession time, and there was an economic slowdown, and everybody just kind of stepped back from a lot of those type projects. And then it just never seemed to really take off again. And I think once the library staff began this discussion about the bookmobile idea, that seemed to be something that we could pursue to try to provide the service all over the county in these places. So it's just, it's not to say that one day maybe
we can take that any place.
Yeah. That's correct.
Yeah.
You can fill those voids across the county.
Let me give you a little history on that, you know, because you might not hear it again. They had a Western Branch Study Committee. Sam Powell was on it. Sam was on the City Council. I was on the County Commissioners. And I'm a big library freak, you know, so, you know, they put me on it. We met down in the basement of May Memorial. Now, this was when they were going to Joel Davison. And I said, first meeting, I said, look, y'all might want to put somebody else on here other than me because I'm not going to vote for it. And then Sam said, well, yeah, it's not fair to put Tim on the hot seat. And I said, now, if you want me to stay on the committee and maybe bring up something that they might support, I'll stay on the committee. They said, yeah. So we went from 15,000 square feet down to 10, but I still said I wasn't going to vote for it. And we met out at Nick's Cuisine, City Council, Burlington. It's a true story. County commissioners. And I won't mention the chairman of the board, of our board at that time. He came up to me and he whispered, he said, Tim, he said, if we all take the heat, you know, if we all vote for it, we'll all take the heat. So I'm not going to vote for it. And it never came to a vote here or in Burlington. And then I think it shifted over to Beth Schmidt Park. That was Bill Huff's wife, Debbie Huff. You remember Debbie Huff?
Yeah, I do.
Her mother.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, that's the last I heard of it. So.
Thank goodness.
And then when we refused to go with Beth Western, Not Best Western. Best. Yeah. Best. Well, when we refused to go with Western, the Western Library, that's when we inherited May Memorial's, what was that, the Sears building that was given?
I think so, yes.
Yeah,
yes.
You had May Memorial Library, but then Sears we inherited building. The yep. other part, which was the old Sears building. I'm not sure. Was that the Gant family that gave that? Was it Gant? Yeah, and then the rest of the library was enlarged. You couldn't have done both. So it really worked out well that we didn't build the Western branch to have gotten the main library enlarged. But I didn't know what happened with Beth, you know, the Beth Schmidt deal. So. All right.
All right.
Now you know.
Thank you for that history.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, me and Tim's been down here forever.
Too long.
All right. Susan Evans, our finance officer, has some items on the agenda.
Good evening, commissioners. Before you this afternoon is a resolution. If you'll remember, during our fiscal year 1920 budget process, county manager included in his budget a listing of capital items that we would like to finance this year. So the request that you have before us is for us to allow the county, it's a resolution that will give staff the authorization to move forward to seek an installment loan in the amount of $1,544,218 to be repaid over 4 years. The equipment list and the cost were included in your board packet. Just a couple of items from the resolution. Basically, we are showing that the taxes have already been increased to cover this debt service, and that staff now has the authority to move forward, and it would give the county manager and the finance department the authorization to issue the proposal at this time.
Motion to approve.
I'll second that, Steve.
So we have a motion and a second to approve the resolution authorizing staff to proceed to obtain a bank financing agreement. Is there any more discussion? If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, what's next?
So the next item is, now that you have approved the resolution, I would like to request that we be able to go ahead and schedule a public hearing for the results of that RFP, that we would hold that public hearing on Monday, September the 16th, 2019 at 7 p.m.
Make a motion to approve that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve setting a public hearing on September 16th at 7 p.m. to review the results from the request for the proposal concerning the equipment and vehicle installment loan. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and last one.
The last item that I have before you is another resolution. It's a reimbursement resolution which will allow the county to go ahead and file the applicable modifications that we will need for our 3 FCC license. This is in conjunction with the equipment process and purchase that we will need to make for CCOM. We're estimating the cost right now to be around $9,000, but this will let us go ahead and expend those funds, and then once the funding has been secured through an RFP bank loan, the county would reimburse itself for that upfront cost.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Great. We have a motion and a second to approve the resolution. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
All right. Next, we have our second round of public speakers. These would be people who have sought to address the board about issues that are not related to agenda items. Before we go into that, just for fun, I'm going to talk about our public comment policy to just remind the public that this is posted on our website. You can review that. Anybody who's thinking about coming to address the board, we encourage you to look for that. You get 3 minutes to make your remarks. There's no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting. And we think of that as being 3 people in support of something or 3 people in opposition to something. Public comment is not intended to require the Board of Commissioners to answer any impromptu questions. Speakers shall address all comments to the commissioners as a whole and not to individual commissioners. Discussions between speakers and members of the audience are not allowed. Speakers should be courteous in their language and presentation. Failure to abide by that may result in forfeiture of the speaker's right to speak. Please don't discuss any of the following: matters which concern the candidacy of any person seeking public office, matters which are the subject of public hearings, closed session matters, and so forth. And don't swear and don't be rude. So, and I don't say all that or call the public's attention to that in response to anything that's happened in the past or anything that's anticipated to happen in the future. It's just good for us to review that as a community every once in a while. So, all that being said, the first speaker for our non-agenda related items is Mr. Charlie Deaton. Is Mr. Deaton here? I don't see him. I don't think that he is. There's not anybody in the overflow room, is there? Let's just make sure. Okay, so Mr. Deaton is not here. Stephanie Thurman, if you may come forward, please.
Welcome. Thank you. My name is Stephanie Thurman. Oh, I forgot. Here's my glasses. I'm sorry. My name is Stephanie Thurman, and I would like to share with you my ongoing experiences with a Class 2 HIDO permitted industry. I'm an adjacent property owner to the solar farm constructed in 2015 on Snow Camp Road. In late 2015, we reached out numerous times to the project manager because of stormwater runoff that was flooding and damaging our property and creating a murky, muddy mess of the pond at the end of our property and our neighbor's pond across Clark Road. I also reached out to the county's director of inspections at the time, Mr. Robert Keyes, who referred me to Libby Hodges, the director of the planning department. Ms. Hodges informed me that the solar farm had been permitted and inspected under the HIDO and that the county currently has no ordinance in place or authority to enforce any sediment or erosion control issues. That's something enforced by the NC Department of Environment and Natural Resources under the DEQ. Ms. Hodges copied my complaint and her response to the NCDENR, and needless to say, they did not respond because looking out for my property rights and following up on issues related to projects permitted under our HIDO is not in the DEQ's stated purpose, which is to provide for the conservation of the state's water and air resources. So at this point, I ask who is responsible for looking out for me to make sure permitted construction does not infringe on my rights as a property owner. The 2011 HIDO states as its purpose to promote the health, safety, and general welfare of the citizens of Alamance County. If that is the case, then it's the county's responsibility to protect our rights as citizens. I continue to deal with problems from the adjacent solar farm, primarily their failure to install and maintain a 30-foot vegetated noise buffer as stipulated in the HIDO. We also continue to experience flooding and standing water at what we call ground zero for the site. It appears to me that violations of the HIDO have no repercussions to the permit holder, and as an impacted citizen, I have little recourse. After 3 years of HIDO violations related to the solar farm, it's frightening to think about the life-threatening ramifications of the proposed Class 4 quarry and its daily impact to our community, especially when the county has clearly demonstrated its inability to handle benign issues associated with a Class 2 site. I hope that we can do better in the future in enforcing the ordinances that are there to protect the rights of citizens. Our quality of life depends on getting this right. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Brian, isn't it something we can do about if it's in the ordinance? They're going to need a 30-foot buffer. Let's force them to put that buffer in.
Yes, I talked with Tanya, and I think Teresa has been out to the site and is talking with the solar farm manager about installing the proper
buffer and berm. So that is being addressed with.
Okay, good. Thank
you. Was that never installed on the original when they finished the solar farm or what?
Yeah, well, where they planted some shrubs, there wasn't any need for them, and they didn't plant any shrubs where there is a need for them, which is my property line, which I have, it's several hundred feet. Well, it goes the entire length of my property, which is 900 feet. But we don't need shrubbery that whole area. But what they did plant, most of it died. And so they just spray Roundup, and it's just not.
Was that on the original plan, Tanya? You mind telling us about it?
So we've been made aware of the situation. We've dealt and talked with the solar farm group. They have gone out and replanted trees in a specific area that Ms. Sermon had given us notice of. Those as well have died this summer because of the heat. So they're replanting in the fall, and they're replanting the five that died and five more in addition to that to make sure that area is covered. Otherwise, per the site plan that was approved way back, everything else is looking good to us.
So we're on top of this, as far as
right. We've dealt with the solar farm. I think you talked to the guys at the solar farm company.
No, he hasn't contacted me yet.
Okay. Well, he's been out there, and we've been out there. We're all, correct me if I'm wrong, but Teresa, you and him are meeting out in the fall when they get their planting schedule. All of y'all are scheduled to go together.
And that makes sense because you plant a tree now, it's going to die then.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, they tried, and it was kind of late spring, early summer when they tried, and then it is done.
Yeah,
right.
Now, what about the standing water? Excuse me, Bill.
November is a stormwater issue. We don't have a stormwater department, so it does have to go through the state for any concerns for stormwater.
Were they supposed to put in a pond or some kind of sedimentation erosion control measures when
the solar farm places rarely even grade their land. They don't have any runoff to have to put a stormwater pond in. They prefer it to be grass and everything, so they come out and mow it periodically, or they put sheep under there. And it's very low maintenance kind of thing. They just put their solar panels on top of the existing ground. They usually use the contours of the land the way it is. That's why they pick those sites. There's very little to do moving any dirt. They don't get a land disturbance permit per se, like a normal development would, because they're not moving dirt.
Yeah, they're not grading the land.
They're not really disturbing the dirt.
But Ms. Thurman, you're saying that's not the case with your site?
They wiped out over 40 acres of forest in that process. I mean, that land, it was very disturbed.
And they didn't put a retention pond?
Depends on what you consider. Taking the trees out is one version of disturbing, but actually moving the dirt is a different definition for the state anyway of how they handle those two.
But she's got runoff and sediment problems. Like, their dirt has slid over onto yours and has messed up your drainage, right?
It hasn't messed up our drainage, but it has messed up the driveway that goes into the lower end of our property, which is what we call ground zero, because that's basically where the solar farm started. They used our property to move all of their equipment. They literally started picking their way over to Snow Camp Road from our property because they had no driveway. And it was just too dangerous to do it, to try to offload their equipment and start from Snow Camp Road. So we let them use our property.
So am I understanding it right, so you have two kind of issues with them. One is the vegetation that's died, and there's supposed to be a screen, and there's not a screen there, which the county's staff has been working with the solar company to get that addressed. Uh-huh. And it's just taken a while. And then the second thing is that there's been some kind of shifting of dirt that has had an adverse effect on your property.
Trees are falling. We've already had to take out one tree that's not on our property because it was about to fall. So it's already, we're already running into some expense with it.
Well, you also have a the opportunity of private help is available to you to hire a lawyer and to sue the solar farm company, possibly, not to give you legal advice or anything, but that would be an avenue that any homeowner or anybody who owns any property, if somebody, if your neighbor and their use of their property is disturbing you, then you can always use your civil action, you know, that's an option that's available to people, so.
Thank you.
Okay, next on our list is Donna Pope. She's coming back. She has a non-agenda item to talk about how we did a good job on the noise ordinance. She got something else to tell us.
She pumped it up at the first
match. Is this going to take 6 months,
Donna? No, sir. I had to come up a second time to see Mr. Sutton again. I missed him at the last meeting, so. All right. Hello again. I am Donna Poe from Snow Camp, and I am here speaking with you tonight again on behalf of our community, and I thank you again. Just as you worked with us through the noise ordinance revision, and thank you again on that, we believe that we can also work with you in resolving the additional issues we are facing with the proposed mine. We are looking forward to the county attorney responding to our attorney's invitation for him to review apparent hydro violations within their application, including critical omissions of streams from the site plan and a missing spacing waiver from an adjacent property owner. We believe that these violations render the permit invalid, and we are eager to get the county attorney's response. Our community members are very concerned about these apparent violations, and I believe that many of them have written to you expressing those concerns. You have just heard from Ms. Thurman, who has experienced firsthand a general lack of concern or response from the county to hydro violations by the solar farm that are impacting her property. And thank you for your open discussion with her on that. That was great. So we are particularly thankful for your request to the county attorney to respond to our attorney's findings of omissions and violations with the mining company's hydro permit application. Even though they can't join us for every meeting, our neighbors eagerly anticipate the update from each one. They are expecting any day now to see an initiation from the county attorney to follow up with our attorney's letter. We are all optimistic for an amicable outcome and would be very thankful at this point to see Mr. Seaway McDonald's apparent initial plan for a housing development on that property to be an alternative outcome. Clearly, adjacent property owners who thought they were selling their land parcels as part of a housing development supported this plan, and according to an informal survey of over 400 members of our listserv just in the past 24 hours, the majority of the Snow Camp community would as well. Surely the mining company can find a more appropriate location for a dangerous blast mine, one that does not jeopardize the health, safety, and drinking water for thousands of peaceful, law-abiding citizens who proudly call Snow Camp, North Carolina, their home. Respectfully, we would like to know what the time frame is for the county attorney's response, and also when to expect the release of county records and information that was requested by our attorney almost 2 months ago. Again, thank you for your care and your concern for the citizens of our county and for working with us to resolve this difficult and highly critical issue. And thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Donald.
Thank you.
Okay, since we usually, I think that we would traditionally go through all the public speakers and have commissioner comments at the end of all of them, but we didn't do that this time because we responded to Ms. Thurman. So at this time, I'll ask if anybody has a response to Ms. Poe.
What's the status in Raleigh?
I've not heard. They requested additional information from the applicant by letter in June, I believe. And I assume they're getting their information in order to make their decision.
It was June 21st. The state told the mining company to provide more information, and they gave them 180 days to do it. So it's kind of in their court for 180 days from June 21st.
End of December, probably.
Well, I hate to be redundant or belabor a point, but and again, I wasn't at the last meeting. I had something real pressing. I apologize. But the two pipe, is it two pipelines that run across that property, Colonial and Plantation?
Think it's just
or
one.
Which
I
one?
I think it's just one.
Which one?
But I'm not sure.
Colonial.
I think it's Colonial.
Yeah. What have they told the state is the downside of it, if any?
Well, Colonial's written a letter to them. I think think you've got a copy of it.
Yeah, I don't remember what it said. Yeah.
But it says that, yes, we have a pipeline, yes, blasting should be controlled within a certain distance of the pipeline. But they didn't want that to interfere with the mining commission's analysis of the mine. As long as their pipeline is protected by a certain distance from blasting, and they gave the technical term for it in their letter.
Yeah, I vaguely remember that. Okay, was there any evidence at all that the pipeline surfaced during the initial approval from Ms. Hodges' office?
I don't recall anything in the application. There might be a location of the pipeline on the map, but I'd have to go back and look at it. The preliminary map. I know it's on the final map.
But you're not sure whether it was on what Ms. Hodges'
office? I think it was listed on there because it's been there since 65 years.
Well, you would think so, yeah.
52, something like that.
The Hydo that the quarry project was permitted under didn't address anything about pipelines. It didn't say anything about it. It wasn't an issue in it. So whether or not there was a pipeline really isn't something that Libby Hodges would have
got her attention in.
Yeah, had to dealt with. And in the subcommittee from the planning board that's been working on revising the that ordinance, that's one of the things that is included in the revision that we'll eventually get.
Well, it's like you and I talked to prior, you know, it may not have been written in there, but anybody that had any, there's a word for it, but I mean, well, that you would have, whether it was written in there or not, you would have done something about it.
Yeah. Well, there's a quarry right next to the tank farm in Greensboro, and the pipeline runs adjacent to that property too. Mm-hmm. So they have ways to protect their pipeline, just like the gas company has a way to protect their natural gas line. They monitor it.
If I remember right from the thing that I saw that the state sent back to the quarry, that June 21st letter, the Alamance Aggregates was told by Colonial Pipeline, if you can keep the percussion, whatever that technical measurement was, within a certain amount around the pipeline, then it's okay. And the state wants Alamance Aggregates to get an engineer to certify that that's the way it's going to be, that they can guarantee that they can meet that requirement of Colonial Pipeline. And I think that that is one of the things that they're supposed to be doing in the next 180 days, is getting that engineer's report so that they know that the pipeline's secure. I think that's correct. Anybody else? Anything to say? Okay. If not, we have Mr. Carl McCormick has signed up to speak.
Thank you. I have a very simple question to ask. I'm a disabled veteran 100%, and I was told by the VA service office across the street over there last week that the state or the county commissioner, whoever, I don't know who's responsible, that's what I'm trying to find out, gives us a $45,000 release on the value of our house as far as paying taxes on it. Now, I'd just like to know who sets that value. Do the commissioners, does the state, who sets it? Who decides that?
Tax department sets the value of your house.
We should get Mr.
No, I mean, who sets the exemption?
The exemption, I believe it's set by the General Assembly. Yes. I think it's the same for everybody across the state of North Carolina. We have our tax administrator here.
He can probably answer that question.
Yeah.
Did you hear the question?
I heard the beginning and I started coming to this.
Okay.
Well, they give a $45,000 reduction on the value of our house if you're 100% disabled veteran. And I just wonder who makes that decision.
Right here.
That's the man right there.
Well, I mean, you approved the exemption. Who sets the $45,000 amount?
Oh, the amount. That's set by the legislature. Right now, there's some discussion. Every few years, there's discussion about this to expand it to $100,000. Mm-hmm. So far, it's not gone through the higher threshold.
Right.
I imagine sooner or later, it probably will get adjusted.
Yeah.
That's where the $45,000.
Well, I only reason I asked is because when I came back from Vietnam in 72, I was spit on at the airport in San Francisco. I was called baby killer the day I got home. And my life since then hadn't been too great, you know. And then, on top of that, about 3 weeks after I got home, I couldn't sleep at night, so I went down to the VA in Durham, and they kept me coming down twice a week for about 6 months, and finally they threw up their hands and said, we don't know what's wrong. And so then, I just got progressively worse over the years, and so 31 years later, when I'm 52 instead of 21, you know, then they say I got PTSD. And also, by that time, I had developed diabetes from the Agent Orange exposure. So it's been real nice, you know, doing this good stuff for the government and them treating us so good and everything about it. I just thought maybe they'd just quit hating us eventually, you know, before I died, because then I would be 70 in December. I hope eventually they'd just quit hating us and treat us like everybody else, you know. But I do thank you for your time.
Well, let me ask you something. Are you getting a $40,000 exemption?
No.
I don't need it now because
I will be around another year or so anyway.
Okay. Well, Mr. McCormick, before you leave, I would really like it if you would talk to Mr. Aikens, our tax administrator, and let him take a look at property.
See,
and let's get you whatever.
My house is worth about $180,000, right?
Yes, sir.
And the difference between that and say $140,000, the difference in taxes don't be that much anyway. I can afford to pay it, so.
Well, it's your money, or
you deserve it.
You need to get your money.
No. They sent us off to a war they knew we couldn't win.
Well.
And then they treated us like dirt when we came back to try to do what the law says. And then they elected two draft dogs as president. So.
I need to set you up with
my
father-in-law.
We could have won it if they'd have let us.
Yeah. But they didn't. So they don't change my status in you at all. I still feel bad, and I still am sick and have to take medicine for the diabetes and everything for the PTSD.
But if you file for that exemption, it will save you some money to help you
It won't matter to me much, because when I die, the wife's going to get her sell the house to get an apartment, because she was by herself, and so it's all the same to me if I don't get the exemption. I just thought some other states, I've talked to some of my friends that I was on the streets with, in some other states, and some of those states, like New Jersey, for example, gives 100% exemption to 100% veteran, you know.
Yes, sir. Well, Mr. McCormick, let me say thank you.
No, I didn't help this country or the Vietnamese either. I didn't do nothing but go over there and risk my life for 18 months. That's all I did. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming out tonight and talking to us. We appreciate it. All right, well, that is the end of the list of our public speakers tonight. So, Mr. Hager, do you have a county manager's report?
Just two quick points for the board to consider. Tanya Cattle has let me know that we're moving right along the process with the land development plan, and there's still an opportunity if the commissioners want to appoint anybody to the committee that's going to be helping steer that. So if you think of folks that you're interested in having them reach out to Tanya, be sure to do that. But do it quickly, because we're moving right along, so that'll be that committee will be solidifying here pretty soon. Another little point I would bring to the board's attention, and hopefully the public that's listening, that we're posting a lot of good information on AlamanceCapitalProjects.com. I know the board receives an update every week what's going on in our capital world between county government projects, school system, ACC, courts. We're sharing that with you. We're putting all that information on the website too. And I would just encourage you to tell folks if they have questions about what's going on with the education bond projects, what's happening with the county's projects. It's a good place to see all that. So that's all that I have.
How many vacancies do we have on that committee, Brian?
Tanya.
Probably at least six. Sometimes five.
It's a good opportunity to be a part of helping to guide county's land use future. So you know folks. Get the word out and tell them. Contact Tommy.
Brian, when is Keenan coming? Have we solidified that date?
It's September 4th, and that will be from 10 till noon, and we're going to meet over here at the across the street at the annex. So we'll be in the big meeting room over there.
Okay.
September
2nd?
September
4th.
September 4th, 10 a.m., 10 till noon.
So that is the joint meeting with the school board?
That's correct.
Okay. to talk about, understand the different models of construction management.
Yes. Yes, that's correct. Give the board opportunity to ask questions about, you know, we're getting, between us and the school system and the community college, we're really getting ready to embark on a lot of capital work. Had the opportunity to hear Mr. Briggs speak to the community college board of trustees. I thought he did a very good job. Very knowledgeable. If you have questions, he'll be very helpful, I believe.
Okay. Thank you. Do we have any commissioner comments tonight?
Yeah, you know, I told you I was going to tell you something. Me, you know, and I forgot. Did you play football in high school with a guy, with a real short guy, a real small guy? For the lack of, I can't think of his name. He real small, real small. real short.
One about a year or two ago, no, Terry.
That's what's wrong with knees. The short guys don't work on their knees.
Yeah, they go in low, that's for sure. Oh, shoot, he said you would know him. But I think it's, was it Stumpy or?
What does he do?
Shorty. I don't know. He his kids, my kids, played with his kids at Cummins. And as kids, they played ball. And I ran into him at a dry cleaner, and he knew you. He said he played ball with you at Southern Alabama. Huh?
Sound like Jordan Burchett.
I'm not sure, but I said, I just want to know, I said, was Terry Johnson as mean as everybody, or he says he is, or tough, and he said, yeah. It tickled me to death, but he said he would walk home from practice, and but he knew you.
Most boys did back then, didn't they, Terry?
You went there?
Walk from practice, walk home.
Heck yeah.
From practice, yeah.
Well, he didn't have a ride, he said, and he'd walk all the way home.
Yeah. Most people didn't. Right.
He said he played ball with you at Southern Alabama. Did you would always come to anybody's defense or whatever? I mean, it was, he pretty much praised you. Oh, yeah.
I'll give him his money
tomorrow. He'll figure that one out, won't
he? I'll tell you one thing. He had a good family, had good kids, and they played ball at Cummins, and all the kids over there got along real good. And he was in there with Doug Moore and Connell Graham and, okay, and that group of kids or coaches. Anyway, that's all. I wish I could remember the name.
Anybody else? It's 7:56. We can about out of here before 8 o'clock.
That's right.
Good, Amy.
All right, then the meeting's adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.